So we've been manipulating variables like origin for quite some time now, but we've never really looked at it in detail. If you peek the definition of pip origin, you'll see it's a vector. Oh boy. 3D vectors. Wait, don't run away just yet. You see, vectors are good for you. I get that you might be afraid of them because you hated them in school, but we're in the practical world now, so don't worry, you can forget everything you've learned about maths in school, and vectors will finally make sense. And if you already know vectors pretty well, you can skip roughly half of this video. So, first of all, the vector class. It's got three members, x, y, and z. And these are coordinates, and you use them to represent positions in space. In Quake, Gold Source, and so on, x is forward, y is left, and z is up. So if you increment pev origin z, your entity is gonna start going up in the air. The vector class has a number of methods you can use, like length, normalize, and some utility functions like dot product and cross product. We will see what most of these mean soon, but for now, I want to give you a basic problem to solve. Let's say we're writing an enemy that will attack the player if they're close enough. Let's say within 100 unit radius. Think about it for a second. How do we figure out if the player is close enough? First, we gotta find a direction vector that goes from the player to the enemy, and then we calculate the distance. If you're having trouble figuring this out, let me simplify this down to just one dimension, okay? So let's say the player's position is 5, and the enemy's position is 12. So what's the distance between them? Obviously it's 7, because it takes 7 units to get from 5 to 12, and we get that by subtracting 12 and 5. If we give these numbers names and transform them into vectors, then we can form a formula. And finally, we just calculate the length of this resulting travel vector and compare it to 100. Now here's the thing. What if we're not interested in the length, but rather in just the direction? We use normalize. Normalize will basically calculate a unit vector based on the current vector. And a unit vector is just a vector whose length is 1. That's really, there's nothing special about it. So now you might be wondering, how does gravity work? How does velocity work? Easy. Velocity is quote-unquote applied to the origin every frame, and gravity is similarly applied to velocity. So what you're gonna get in a free fall is a constantly growing velocity vector which points down due to gravity, which in return brings the origin down on the z-axis. Because velocity is represented by a number, you can check how fast you're actually falling, and that's basically how fall damage works. If velocity z is less than, I don't know, -100 or so, then take away some health. It's that simple. And finally, before we move on to Half-Life specific stuff, I want to mention something called a dot product. We will be talking exclusively in the context of unit vectors because it gets a little tricky with non-unit vectors. But anyway, dot product is a function that takes two vectors and returns a number which indicates how similar those two vectors are. 1 if they're the same, 0 if they're completely different, and -1 if they're facing opposite directions but are the same otherwise, and anything in between actually. So in other words, a dot product is the projection or a shadow of one vector onto another. One of the many uses of the dot product is comparing the angle between vectors. If two vectors are 90 degrees apart, as I said before, the dot product is gonna be 0. If they're 60 degrees apart, the dot product is gonna be 0.5, and so on. If we plot this on a graph, you get a cosine wave. So, if you know the angle between two vectors, the dot product from is the cosine of that angle. Anyway, I will likely make another video about vectors specifically, but I think this is enough to move on. So, with that said, let's take a look at the utility function, utilMakeVectors. This function's name is pretty ambiguous and it's kinda stupid, but it simply calculates three local direction vectors based on the input angles. A forward, right, and up vector, basically. And it's nothing special, really, you just give angles to it and it's gonna store the results in GP Global's vectors. For example, when all angles are 0, the resulting forward vector would be 100. facing the positive x-axis, which is the forward axis, right? As we turn up the pitch angle and reach 90 degrees, it becomes 001. Now, let's put all of these concepts to use and improve our camera entity from before. Let's say it has a generous field of view of about 60 degrees. But wait, how do we determine if some entity is within that FOV? Remember what I said about dot products and angles and the cosine? Well, we'll get to that soon. You gotta calculate three things, basically. A forward vector for the camera based on its angles, a direction vector from the camera to the entity, and the dot product of these two vectors above. And then, it's just a matter of comparing the dot product's value. Essentially, we are checking how similar the forward vector is to the direction vector, because that is a good way to measure the angle. If the vectors are the same, the angle between them is 0 degrees, which is inside the FOV. Now, if they're too different, say 90 degrees apart, then it's most likely not in the FOV. And we chose 0.5 because that's what a cosine of 60 degrees is. Remember the graph I showed earlier with the cosine wave? We are looking for all the angles that are less than 60 degrees. And for all of those, the dot product is higher than 0.5. So we're basically looking at anything above 0.5 because, you know, that's less than 60, and less than 60 is our FOV. Try to figure this out, draw it on paper and stuff like that, but anyway. In its current design, the camera will always face the player and perform a trace line to determine visibility. Let's just redesign this whole thing, because it's really janky. The camera will start off by rotating itself constantly. If it spots the player in its FOV in a 512 unit radius, then it's gonna stop and trigger its targets. We will write three additional methods, so the think method doesn't get too messy. And we'll also keep track of the intruder. In the find intruder method, we will simply search entities by radius. And if the potential intruder is visible, then return that. Now, we just gotta implement isVisible. Essentially, here is a simple FOV check and a traceline check. And you may have figured out by now that this is almost exactly how AI sight works in Half-Life. That's literally how the AI sees things. And finally, the rotation logic. It's super simple. I don't think I even have to explain it, except maybe the very last part. We are multiplying this number 15 by frame time, because remember, this is called every frame, approximately every 16 milliseconds, that is. Imagine what would happen if you added 15 degrees every fraction of a second. That would spin crazy fast. So we multiply by the frame time, which is a pretty small number that will balance this out for us. And finally now, we just gotta rewrite the think method. We can throw out all of that old detection code and replace it with this new code. It is much simpler now, and we can easily extend it. For example, you can make the camera reset itself after enough time has passed. I'll let you do that and a couple of other things for homework. But yeah, that's about it. In the next video, we're going to look at animated models, see how to play animations and stuff like that. So until then, happy programming!